NASA's view from space shows our planet is changing, but to really understand the depths of these changes and what they mean for our future, scientists need a closer look. This year, NASA takes you on a 6-month world tour with major new field research campaigns to study regions of critical change from the land, sea, and air.
Earth Expeditions is taking off.
That's right, and first it's by plane to the pristine landscapes of Greenland.
So we're literally taking off. I'm so excited.
Like the royal we, like you and I?
Yes, I thought so.
Yeah, we're not going anywhere.
Wait, what?
Yeah, but fortunately, we've got some great people in the field to talk to.
I guess that works too. The first mission that we're checking out looks at global sea level rise and how oceans are melting away the edges of Greenland ice sheets.
Wait, so oceans are melting Greenland?
Yes, oceans melting Greenland.
OMG, that sounds serious.
SMHTOM.
Oh, I don't know that one.
Shaking my head, Tom.
Oh.
Well, we caught up with the team as they're prepping gear and getting ready for our first expedition.
Let's hear from the OMG team themselves, pre-mission, as they prep the G3 aircraft and the team prepares for its first important mission.
We'll BRB after OMG. Roll the tape.
OMG. Oh my goodness, right? Not anymore. OMG stands for Oceans Melting Greenland. It took dozens of people to get this mission to where it is today. We have about 10 people on the science team who helped write the proposal, plan all the science, but then there's dozens more people who worked on the actual instrument, pilots, a project manager in charge of all that stuff. So there's a whole lot of really capable people who've done amazing work to get us to where we are today.
OMG is a very exciting mission that hopes to answer the question, is the warming ocean involved in the recent observed melting of many of Greenland's glaciers? We are using the GLSEN radar to map in a very, very high resolution the surface of almost all of the glaciers that end in the ocean around Greenland.
So the radar will tell us how tall and what the extent of the marine terminating glaciers around Greenland are, and we'll look for changes in that over time.
It will be an amazing opportunity to collect these data over many years. When you have both sides of this relationship being monitored at the same time. And this, to my knowledge, has never happened before on the same scale, both in time and space.
At the end of OMG, I think we'll get a much better understanding of the relationship between the ocean and the ice sheet, and specifically how and where a warming ocean is going to accelerate the melting of Greenland and as a consequence, the rising of global sea levels.
That was really cool. I didn't realize how much preparation goes into these things.
Yeah, it's a tough road for the scientists because not only do they have to get the instruments together and make sure they're all working, they've got to plan thousands of miles of flight lines, like literally pick where the plane is going to go.
That's crazy. So what are we looking at here? This is NASA's G3 airplane at Palmdale, California, coordinated by Armstrong Research Center, right?
Right, and along with Johnson Space Center in Houston, and also NASA's Jet Propulsion Lab, which is where the scientists are from. What a lot of people don't realize, you know, you hear G3, this is a standard business jet, but it's special for NASA. It's got holes in it where instruments can go through, and it's got all kinds of fancy high-tech gear inside. Yeah, here's a shot of the inside, and you can see, you know, this is all the way, you know, here's the scientist, Josh Willis, up here right by the pilots. You can see all the gear going back inside of it.
So we have the scientists and the pilots. What are the other types of people that are involved in this project?
So these instruments usually require people to adjust them while they're flying because the thing that you're trying to measure is changing. So you know, like it's a radar, you need to change things like the power of the radar while you're going.
So this is cool because this is actually the radar right here underneath the airplane.
Yeah, and it's hard to believe, you know, here's that thing, it's gonna fly over the ice thousands of feet in the air and it's gonna shoot radar signals down.
The instrument, the GLSEN instrument, is actually shooting down radar waves to the glaciers And then it waits for the return signal to come back up with other radar waves. And the aircraft will be flying over and will capture those signals.
I know, and I always find this hard to believe, that you can actually measure the timing of all this and you know the speed at which the radar propagates, so you can figure out how high the ground is underneath the plane.
Isn't there a cool story about how this radar was developed?
Yeah, it started out, it was called UAVSAR, and they were building it to literally recreate what we see on radar satellites on a plane. But there was an engineer on the project at JPL, her name's Delwyn Mahler, and she had the idea, with just some small tweaks to that radar, she could make the most precise radar mapping instrument ever made. And what's amazing about it is that you get very, very precise measurements over a very, very broad area, and it's the first instrument of its kind that way.
Cool.
The big thing about GLSEN, though, is that it's going to be the first very, very high resolution measurement all the way around Greenland.
Huh. So what are we expecting to see, or what have we already seen in terms of the Greenland ice sheet?
So one of the important things about OMG is that it's going to connect up changes in the ocean with the changes in the ice.
So we're losing a lot of ice here on Earth, but why is that important to study? Why is that important to know?
Yeah, there's two big things. You know, number one, you can think of ice like a mirrored hat on top of the planet. And so when sunlight comes in, it gets reflected off that mirrored hat, keeps our head cool. Take that mirrored hat off, sun hits your head, you get hotter. And that's happening around the Earth as we lose ice and snow. There's one other thing, and it's special about Greenland. Where you have ice up on a continent or up on land, when we lose that ice, we transfer water and ice into the ocean, and that raises sea level. And right now, sea level's rising around all around the world because we're losing that land-based ice. And OMG is trying to understand why we're losing so much ice from Greenland.
It's incredible that it's all originating from this one place. It just kind of shows the interconnectedness of our Earth system.
Oh yeah, and one of the other things about NASA, right, is that we study the Earth as a system. And if you want to understand, like, why it's getting hot in one part of the Earth and how that relates to changes in cloud cover and things, you need that kind of satellite perspective. But you also need to get down into the dirt, or into the ice in this case.
And that's where the Ocean Belt in Greenland team comes in.
That's right, and we've got aircraft and research vessels on the case off the coast of Greenland. They're making observations in the water and in the air.
So for the first leg of OMG, they're actually going to Greenland for glacier mapping using NASA's G3. But later on this year, they're actually going to be using drop sondes for ocean profiling. But we'll talk about more about that later.
Yeah, that's right. And let's take a look at what the team's done now off the coast of Greenland and Iceland.
Yeah, this is on. Check. 1, 2, 3, 4. Semblance. Pilot to co-pilot. Pilot to co-pilot. Come in, please.
Go ahead. Get flag clear, Co.
Okay, go. All right. Test complete.
We're in Keflavik. This is day number 5 of our OMG deployment, first year of the OMG deployment. And so far we've collected 2.2 terabytes of data. And so today we're going back to Greenland and we're going to image more of the glaciers.
Sometimes you'll see this, the attitude indicator, these pitch bars kind of roll the airplane, either roll or pitch or dive somehow. It'll just be a real quick momentary excursion. What can you tell us about this ocean melting Greenland campaign, what we're doing up here?
Well, we're basically flying over Greenland and measuring how tall the glaciers are.
There's a lot of the time where it's undercast and it's just low clouds, and you could be over Arizona or anywhere else. It just doesn't look any different. It's just clouds. Then other times when it's clear below and you see all the way to the ground, it's just breathtakingly beautiful. Extremely rough terrain, lots of snow and ice, and lots of mountains. It's just really very impressive.
So what is a glacier? A glacier is basically a big river of moving ice, which carries ice off the ice sheet and into the ocean. Actually, not every glacier ends in the ocean, but most of the ones in Greenland do, and that's part of the reason why we're so interested in whether the oceans are melting away the edges of the glaciers and draining the ice sheet.
Today was really exciting because we flew over a pair of glaciers which actually run from the north and south and collide in a huge ridge before breaking off into icebergs and filling up a fjord full of chunks of giant ice. It was incredibly dramatic to see, and it's an incredibly important glacier and glacier system because it drains a huge amount of ice from the ice sheet.
Very nice, very nice.
Well, that's important science, and the team is doing it right.
This is all very cool, and I'm so excited about seeing Earth expeditions in action and in the field, but I wanted to see what your reactions were. So I went out and I asked you guys some questions.
What planet in our solar system does NASA study the most?
Mars.
Mars.
I have absolutely no idea.
Mars.
Pluto, because they don't know if it's a planet or not.
Mars.
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 Did you guys just say Mars because she said Mars?
No.
Kinda.
This one.
This one. Earth is correct.
Earth.
Earth, yes.
Earth?
By like sending people out into space, I guess.
A boat?
Yeah, so we use boats. Do you have any pets?
Yeah.
What pet do you have?
A dog.
A dog. So we actually use dog sleds in some areas too. Isn't that cool?
Yeah.
Satellites.
Oh, satellites.
Satellites, yay!
Studying the soil and the atmosphere with scientific instruments.
I don't know, a thermometer.
And I'm probably exploring it, like exploring the ocean and kind of just like exploring, I guess, the unknown of Earth.
Radars.
Why do you think studying our Earth is important?
Because we live on it and we have to make it sustainable. And if we're not doing that, what are we doing? And the Earth gives so much to us. Why wouldn't we give back?
Because I think it's very important with the environment and, of course, the changes that go on, I mean, with it.
I think that the seasons are changing, like the time of year. I think they're definitely changed. I don't know if that's got anything to do with it.
I think it's been happening for a really long time and no one really talks about it. I think it's kind of frightening.
Where, like, in some cold places, like, they can, like, it makes things hot.
I live on an island, so yes, very much so.
It's definitely something that we as human beings affect, and I think a lot of people don't think about that at all. That's definitely problematic because if we want to continue living like we do, I think we definitely have to make changes.
That it infects population and environment and...
You see that the weather pattern is changing, like we had like a fixed duration wherein we had winter. Now you see that it's moving and it's still cold, supposed to be like proper spring.
Because I think we're doing things that are damaging the climate?
Because I think there's evidence that over time we have done damaging things that are not necessarily reversible at this time.
Earth is definitely my favorite planet. I mean, where else are you going to find cool people like that?
Earth is definitely my favorite planet too. And if you want to follow along online, tweet us at #EarthExpedition or check out our Facebook page.
So Tom, why is Earth your favorite planet?
Keeps me grounded.
Well, you know, Pluto is my favorite dwarf planet because it's so far out.
What about our closest neighbor, the planet Venus?
I don't like talking about Venus. It's just a little too close to home.
True, but there's no place like home. Also, Earth has Netflix.
Right, but I feel like streaming video on Pluto would just take so much time. We have so much lag.
Okay, that's enough.
That means I won this pun challenge.
Let's return to Earth. And on Earth to NASA's Langley Research Center in Virginia, Jim Crawford is working on our next Earth expedition, the Korea-U.S. Air Quality Mission, or as we call it, CHORUS-AQ. I got to sit down and chat with Jim about this important air quality mission. So Jim, what's the most important thing you hope to accomplish with CHORUS-AQ?
When the CHORUS-AQ flights are finished, we really hope to have a data set that will show the distributions of pollution over East Asia and will test current models and current satellite algorithms to make sure that we can find the improvements we need to improve our ability to monitor air quality. Well, flying 3 aircraft over the Korean Peninsula is not an easy task, and so there's still a lot of coordination to make sure that we can find the right flight permissions and right flight profiles to gather the data that we need.
And how's the planning going for this mission? This is a big one.
It's probably the most complex mission we've ever done. We have over 20 instruments on the plane from the U.S. and an additional 5 instruments from the Korean investigators. So we've never had that quite of an international mix on the plane before. Also, 3 planes in the air with a lot of ground sensors makes this a very complex experiment.
What really excites you about this mission?
What really excites me about the mission is that we're looking at a future where satellites will be used across the entire Northern Hemisphere in a cooperative fashion to look at air quality. This experiment is our first chance to work with our Korean colleagues to make that a reality.
I'm ready for all the great science to come in. Thanks for the update, Jim.
Thank you.
We'll have more on Chorus AQ coming to you soon.
Next up, we learn a little bit about NASA's flying laboratory, the DC-8, which plays a big role in 2 Earth expeditions this year, including Chorus AQ.
NASA's DC-8 is a jetliner that has been highly modified to support the agency's airborne science program. Built in 1969, the aircraft is currently based at the NASA Armstrong Flight Research Center, Hangar 703 in Palmdale, California, and is one of few DC-8s still operating in the world. The DC-8 is outfitted with specialized optical windows, probe ports, and electronic modifications to support a wide array of scientific instruments. These assets, combined with its long-duration flight capability, large payload capacity, and laboratory environment, make it one of the premier research aircraft available for NASA's Science Mission Directorate. Data gathered with the aircraft have been used for a variety of Earth science study applications, including ecology, geography, hydrology, meteorology, oceanography, volcanology, atmospheric chemistry, cryospheric science, soil science, and biology.
Tom, it's just incredible how adaptable the DC-8 is.
Yeah, you know, NASA's aircraft are really at the cutting edge of science and engineering, from the tiny G3 that just holds a few people and instruments mapping Greenland, to the giant DC-8 that can hold dozens of people and many instruments that's going to be doing air quality over South Korea.
Yeah, and how monumental OMG and Chorus AQ are going to be for helping us understand how the planet works.
And that's just 2 of our missions. We actually have 8 going all over the planet this year.
That's so cool.
What are you doing?
I'm tweeting about this.
I'm excited about how OMG is going to be a new base layer for understanding glaciers for decades to come.
And after this field campaign, we'll know how big glaciers are and how they're changing.
Right. And what we really need to understand is how change is happening all over our planet, and NASA is on top of it.
So I think that's a wrap for today's NASA's Earth Expeditions.
Keep tuning in for more information.
And remember, it's hashtag Earth Expedition on social media, and we look forward to hearing what you have to say about our field campaigns.